Hi everybody. Today we will solve some more examples for the plasma systems where electric field is perpendicular to the magnetic field. And we assume that magnetic field is in Z direction as usual, okay? And electric field is in Y direction and constant, okay? And constant. These magnetic and electric fields, as you see, can change not only in space but also in time. But in our simple example, we are assuming that E0 and E0 are constants. Okay. Also, we assume initial velocity totally to be zero. So the motion starts at the at y I0 is equal to minus EY over EY over B omega C or E0 over B0 omega C. Okay. The reason that Y0 is given by like this is because we would like to cancel some terms and make the equations look simpler. This is the reason that this kind of initial Y value is given. Of course, in this case, X0 and Z0 are constant zeros. Okay. So basically what's happening is that in this three-dimensional space where this is X, Y, and Z, magnetic field is totally in Z direction, but electric field in Y direction. Okay? Electric field is in this direction. So and the motion starts with zero velocity at Y equals some negative value right there. Okay? So the distance is E0 over B0 omega C. So probably because when the object is when the charge is stationary, the magnetic field doesn't apply any force, but the first force that is applied will be due to the electric field. Probably the charge will move in this direction initially, okay, towards right, and then continue cycling because of the magnetic field. So we know that, for instance, the y component of the velocity will increase because the force, which is given by QE, okay, is towards y direction. Okay, so let's write the equation of motion. So the first component of the equation of motion, mdvx over dt, which is acceleration in this is x direction. So the total force is due to the Lorentz force with the magnetic field. Coming from, remember that QV cross B, okay, plus QE were the two components of the Lorentz force, okay? So the right-hand side, the X component of this, there is no electric field component because electric field is in totally Y direction, but QV cross B has a X component, which is given by QVYBZ, okay, or B0. Let's just assume this is B0 and B0. So MdV y over dt, so the equation of motion in y direction now has two components. One of them is QE0, and the other is minus sign QVXV0. Okay? As you see, these are coupled equations. So the solution for Vx depends on Vy, and the solution of Vy depends on Vx. So that these are coupled equations, which cannot be solved independently. So they are dependent on each other. So now, what about the z component? And dvz over dt is equal to totally zero because no z component due to magnetic force and no z component due to the electric field. Okay, so basically we will have just zero because initial velocity is zero also. Vz will be totally zero, but because this is also equal to dz over dt and initial z is zero, everything is zero, so z equals zero also. So it means that the motion is going to be kept, okay, going to be kept on y plane, xy plane only, xy plane only, okay. So motion is on xy plane. Okay, this is good observation. It means that no this charge, which has a mass and charge, with this test particle, which has a charge Q and the mass m, okay, will be able to be moving around around this plane, probably doing this kind of motion, we will show that it will actually, and it will stay on XY plane. Okay, so let's put the results together and see how we can solve this. So we define now a new quantity, which is omega as before, okay? Omega is equal to, okay, omega c, which we define as cyclotron frequency, okay? So omega c is just qb0 m, okay? This omega c, cyclotron frequency. And what else do we have? We don't need to specify any other thing. So now what we have is that if we put this into this expression and just rearrange, what we get is dvy over dt, okay, which is equal to e0 over b0 omega c minus omega c vx, and the time rate of the x velocity is given as just omega c vy. Okay, so in order to be able to insert this into this equation, we have to take the time derivative of this totally, so that the right hand side is dy over dt, and then we can insert this expression for that, so that we end up with only one equation in terms of vx. So this is the technique that we are using, as you see, for the coupled equations. So from this we can write vx double dot, which shows that the second derivative, which is equal to omega c vy dot. But vy dot is given here, so this is vy dot, a new notation for the derivative. Okay, now when we insert this expression here, okay, omega, of course, being multiplied by omega c, write everything, e0 over b0, okay, omega c minus omega c vx, okay. Now when you multiply this, you get omega c square all over, so that vx double dot, okay, will be equal to omega c square e0 over b0. Maybe this is there will be some kind of simplification, okay, but doesn't matter, just keep it this way, and the term which is related to vx will be omega c square just vx. As you see, this is like an oscillatory solution. So since we have this extra constant, we assume that the solution for vx should look like this, okay? Vx should be like a times sine omega ct plus b cosine omega ct. We don't know if it is sine or cosine. Actually, this will be determined by the initial conditions. Don't forget, this is initial condition. IC is initial conditions, okay? We're not solving the boundary problem. It's just the initial value problem. It means that initially we give some kind of condition for the particle, and then we follow it afterwards, and everything is a function of time. As you see, although the space is also changing, but everything will be a function of time. So and then we will have another constant, and we say that this constant is just e0 over b0, because e0 over b0 has dimension of velocity, okay, e0 over b0. How can we see this? How can we see this? Look at this. This equation tells me that this is like force, right? Mdv over dt. So, and there is charge and also velocity. So velocity, qvb and qe should be in this with the same dimension of the force. But in this case, v, as you see, V should be with the same dimension as E, because Q's will cancel. And then from here, we can see that V is the same as E over B. Okay, so the dimension of E over B is V. From this comparison of Lorentz force, the terms, we can see that E over B is in velocity dimension. So this must be given like that. The reason that we give this is because we know exactly that this constant should be the solution. Instead of this, we could also say that this is equal to some kind of constant c, and then we can derive what c is. After taking several derivatives, we can see that this c is just e0 over b0. If you want, let's do it this way, okay? So this is the simple solution proposition. So solution. So possible solution. But we are not sure that this is really the solution of this equation. Which equation? This equation, okay? The equation is a function of x, vx equation. So now, in order, if this solution is correct, we have to insert this into this equation and see if this equation satisfies this differential equation, second degree differential equation. But we have to do something before that. Because now we know that initially there is no velocity. There is no velocity because initial velocity is zero. So if we put t equals zero, okay, this term gives zero, but this term doesn't. So we discard this part. So we say that b equals zero because this term doesn't give you zero at t equals zero. So this for simple assumption, okay? But there is also possibility that maybe after this being zero, okay, this cosine zero is one, and b plus c gives you zero. This is also possible. Either this, okay, or nothing is equal to zero. This is second option. So there are some options we can use. So that's why we just keep both terms because we don't know which one is which. Let me repeat. At t equals zero, we expect no vx velocity. So when we set t equals zero, this term goes away, but this term survives. Usually, if there was no term like this constant term, then we would really set b to zero because we would say that there is no way that this equation will be zero at t equals zero, then b should be zero. But not in this case, because there is also another constant. Maybe this constant will make this surviving term zero after added. Okay, this is the reason that we don't really go into this kind of business, but we just keep taking derivatives and inserting into the equations. Okay, so now what is vx dot? Vx dot is just omega c cosine omega c a cosine omega ct plus with a minus sign, of course. The derivative of sine is positive sign, but the derivative of cosine is minus, so the minus sign is here, not there. Okay. Omega c times b sine omega ct, and no contribution from this term because it's just constant. So if you take another derivative, it's just now minus omega c squared, another omega c will be multiplying the term, a times sine omega ct, okay, minus omega c squared again, b cosine omega ct. In other words, this vx double dot will be equal to minus omega c squared vx minus c, right? Vx, but vx vx is given by this expression. So we just write it like it is vx, this vx. Now what happened? As you see, omega c squared is vx from this side and omega c squared from that side cancel each other, and then we see that minus omega c squared times c is just c omega c squared equals omega c squared e zero over b zero. Wow, it's interesting because when these cancel, we see that C is just indeed E0 over B0. This is just a simple solution. And if this is so, then this is exactly the solution. Okay, now we know that the solution for this C will be just E0 over B0. Okay, so this is done. So you can do this also on your own to satisfy yourself. But anyway, Vx is given by that. But we are not done yet, right? We're not done yet. Because now we have to get these coefficients, otherwise there is no solution. There is no solution. Now let's insert the initial conditions. Initial condition. Initial condition tells me that in terms of velocity, of course, all velocities should vanish. So at t equals zero, which is initial conditions, okay, we know that this velocity is zero. Zero should be equal to zero because sine omega zero is zero plus b because cosine omega c cosine zero is one b plus e zero over b zero, okay. B zero. As you see here, b is simply equal to minus e zero over b zero. Now we handled this coefficient, but we didn't handle this a yet, okay. So now, as you see, we are approaching the correct solution. Now from this initial condition, we are able to observe that Vx should be A sine omega ct minus E0 over B0, or let's put it this way, 1 minus omega cosine omega ct. Okay, so we have this solution. We're not done yet, okay? We're not done yet. Now we have to go Vy, okay? We have to get Vy from this. Because look at this equation. If we take the time derivative of this Vx, it's just equal to Vy multiplied by omega c. So omega c times Vy will be just the time derivative of this expression, which is just now omega c a cosine omega ct, okay? And no contribution from this constant, but now the derivative of cosine is minus, so that there is minus sign, it will be plus e0 over b0, okay, sine with omega c, of course, when we take the derivative, the omega c is to be written here, sine omega ct. So this will be just, now we can cancel omega c's all over, and then we see that Vy is equal to, okay, a cosine omega ct plus e0 over b0, okay, sine omega ct. Now we are ready to get a. Why? Because at t equals zero, again, initial condition, we know that velocity should vanish. So this must be zero at t equals zero. So this must be zero at t equals zero, which gives you a because cosine zero is one. And then as you see here, it's just nothing. It's just nothing because at t equals zero, this vanishes. And now what we have seen is that a is to be zero. So a is zero. So basically, we see that this term does not exist. So now what we have is a solution, okay, is this. So Vx will be equal to, Vx is just E0 over B0 minus cosine of, let's write the coefficient here also, E0 over B0 cosine omega ct, and Vy will be given as just simply this term, E0 over B0, okay, sine omega ct. It's just sine and cosine. Now we can get x and y from this, okay? So since this is equal to dx over dt, and this is equal to dy over dt, we can really solve dx and dy by just integrating this function, which we get like this, okay? So y will be equal to e0 over b0 integral of sine omega ct plus some kind of constant, okay? Okay, but this constant, say y0, is given by this expression, okay? Then we see that this y0 will cancel something. Anyway, so let's do this. So y will be equal to e0 over b0, and as you see, when you take the derivative, omega c comes to the in front of this function as product, but when you take the integration, it goes down. So it's 1 over omega c. So sine is the derivative of minus cosine. So the result, so integral of sine omega ct is cosine omega ct. Okay, now we put the limits, but now instead of putting the limits, okay, we can also use this y0 but let's do this, okay? Instead of inserting y0, we say 0 and anytime t. So of course, then we dt here. So we use these primes, and the reason was explained before, because integration or whatever integration function is, integration variable, this boundary cannot have the same thing. So it's the same thing, but except the notation. So now the integration of this, but from zero to any time t, then now this is written as t prime. Now, as you see, y equals e zero over b zero omega c times cosine omega c t minus one, because cosine is one, cosine zero is one, right? So now at t equals zero, as you see, at t equals zero, this gives you one minus one, which is zero, okay? So that y zero is also zero, okay? So this solution actually is the solution for this y zero to be zero. So initially, probably it was wrong to give this, and then instead of starting this charge at this point, if we start the charge at this point, right? In this case, we will have exactly correct solution, okay? Now cancel this initially given boundary condition. We can say that initial condition y zero also zero. So everything starts at the center with no velocity, okay? And the motion will be towards right, obviously, because the electric field is in y direction, and there will be some kind of cycling. So basically, now y is given. We have solved y, and x can be solved also from this, okay, from vx. So from this, let's look at this, okay? Now, dx over dt, since dx over dt is given as this expression, okay, x will be equal to just the integral of a, which was zero, just e zero over b zero, okay, minus e zero over b zero cosine omega c t dt. So we have to integrate this function to solve for x. It's simple, because x will be equal to, now this part gives you e zero over b zero times t, right? Because the integral of the constant is just t, and then minus e zero over b zero divided by omega c, because of the property of the integration, but cosine omega c is the derivative of sine omega c t, so sine omega c t prime, and now the limits are zero and t. As you see, the lower limit doesn't make any difference, but x will be simply given by e zero over b zero, okay, t minus e zero over b zero, okay, omega c sine omega c t. This is it. Okay, sine omega c t. Now, as you see, now this expression is correct with this initial condition. When y zero is given as zero, and we have x zero also zero. Let's check if it's zero. It is correct, because t equals zero, sine is zero, and this is zero, and x zero is zero also. So everything is satisfied. But now, look, you can say that actually, you can put this expression to the left, okay? And then what happens is that y minus one, y minus this, so if you just rewrite these expressions, these two expressions, y minus e zero over b zero omega c, okay, will be equal to e zero over b zero omega c cosine omega c t, okay? Now if you write this expression, having only sine on the right hand side, okay, with a minus sign probably, e zero over b zero omega c again, sine omega c t, okay? But now it will be x minus e zero over b zero t, okay? E zero over b zero t. As you see, now we have if you square this, okay, if you take the square of these functions and then add them up, what do you get is that y minus e zero over b zero omega c, okay, square plus x minus e zero over b zero t square, okay, t square, so everything square will be equal to e zero square over b zero square omega c square. And then now look what happens to this omega c square and multiplication of this. Since omega c equals just q b zero over m, okay, omega c square is q b zero square over m, and then we get some kind of equation, but the simplest case is just Larmor radius square. So Larmor radius is just e zero b zero omega c. So as you see, this is like a circular case but shifting towards right, okay. So if you just graph this, okay, if you just graph this, you can see that it's just cycloid, okay. So now it will be like that, okay. And now if we draw this in x and y plane, this is what we will see exactly. So okay, so this is now, if we draw y here and x here and z there, everything is kept in y x direction, we see that everything starts here with no initial velocity, but since electric field is in this way, the test charge just goes this way, and then it starts doing this kind of motion. Okay, this is there is a drift, as you see. So the charge starts moving like that, and don't forget, electric field is in y direction and magnetic field is in z direction. Okay, so electric field is in this direction and z magnetic field is in this direction. Okay, but the motion is towards x direction, so this is some kind of drift. So this is drift. We call this kind of thing is drift. When E cross B, E is perpendicular to B, the speed of the particle or the test charge is always towards the direction which is perpendicular to E cross B. So this is called E cross B drift. Okay. So this is very important in physics. As you see, you're applying the electric field and magnetic field in such directions that you would like to get the drift in the direction which is perpendicular to to both of them. So okay, so all the motion is kept in xy plane, as you see, but this is called E cross B drift. So this circular motion with a drift in x. Okay, so this is also circular motion with a drift in x. Okay, and as you see, this look at here, the radius of this drift, of course, omega c is q b zero over m, is a function of charge, of course, but the drift velocity, if you look at the drift velocity, okay, the drift velocity is not going to be a function of charge. Okay, so it doesn't matter what kind of charge do we have, E cross B will always give the drift in this case, in this way. Okay, good. So now let's talk about in general we see that in general velocities, you're not responsible from this, but I would like to give you, in general the velocity is given as v parallel plus v perpendicular. Okay, v parallel to v perpendicular. Parallel means, okay. Parallel means in the direction of magnetic field. So parallel to B field, and this is perpendicular to B field. So we can specify, we can just divide this velocity into two pieces. One is parallel and the other is perpendicular. And now what's happening is that this omega C cross RL, okay, as a vector, okay, because omega C has this, but you can see that omega C vector also is just Q B0 vector divided by M. So it's just a way of showing this. Also, not only the magnitude, but also direction is specified. And this is Larmor radius, which is this exactly. So you can calculate from here. And plus another term, which is E cross B, which is coming from this E cross B drift over B0 square, okay, magnitude. Of course, this is like E0 and B0 we have now. And then Z component in general, the velocity. If you solve this problem in general case, in which all the velocities, initial velocities are not zero, so initial position is not zero, then in general solution, we can see all these terms being added, okay? And these terms, which Q E zero over M times T, remember that this was one of the component of probably VY velocity, okay? And then plus VZ0, maybe in Z direction, okay? So as you see, this is parallel to magnetic field, but this is perpendicular to the magnetic field. Why? Because cross means that whenever you have cross product, it's always perpendicular to both vectors which are being multiplied. So this result is perpendicular to both E0 and B0, and this also is perpendicular to B0 because omega C has B inside, okay? Good. So this is perpendicular component and this is parallel component. So in general, the velocities are given by this kind of expression. So now it may have initial velocity and then the time Z position would increase in time, okay? Also, these kind of cross products show some kind of oscillations, okay? This is like a linear motion, but these are oscillations. So basically, we can specify the behavior of the charge by this kind of expression. Of course, when you take the derivative of this function with respect to time, you can also get X and Y as a function of time, which shows you the correct position and location of the charge, okay? In our case, this simple case, it was a cycloid motion, okay? So we also specify another thing I would like to tell you. We talk about also the guiding center drift, V guiding center, okay? This is guiding center drift velocity. So it means that if there is a force acting on a charge, if you just, and the magnetic field exists, okay, then F cross B divided by Q B0 square gives you just guiding center drift, okay? So let me give you an example. So let's assume that the force is like QE and we apply the electric field using two plates which are which are loaded with different charges plus and minus. So electric field is in this way, okay? Electric field is in this way. So the force on the charge is this way for positive charge, okay? Force is this way, okay? Now if we apply the magnetic field in this direction, so let's put these directions X, Y, and Z. Z is perpendicular to the plane. So if we apply the magnetic field in Z direction, Okay, then F cross B gives you downward motion, and then do you know what will happen? This will just drift down. This particle will drift. So this is guiding center drift. In our case, this force was created by just the electric field. As you see, it's exactly the same case, okay? Electric field, okay, this is called perpendicular drift, circular motion with perpendicular drift, but this is circular motion with also perpendicular drift, but called guiding center drift, okay? So just keep this in mind. If we insert this force, we can easily find. And also the other definition that I would like to make is the current density, because we will use these definitions later on. Okay, the current density is given by J, which is current divided by area. Okay, area. Now, in our case, the current density, if it is written in terms of guiding center, okay, it's given by, okay, just NQV, okay, and this is equal to QN force cross B, okay, divided by QB0 square. And these Qs cancel, and then the current density can be written as okay, just N, okay, Q, N F cross B divided by B zero square. Okay, so this is current density due to this guiding center drift. Because when these are electrons, you apply electromagnetic field in such directions so that the guiding center is in totally different direction. In this case, we have a current density in this direction, and it's given by this. So if you insert the force expression, then you can really see that there is a drift, okay, guiding center drift. This force also can be considered as mg, gravitational force, right? Gravitational force. So now let's do this experiment, okay? Let's do this experiment. Now we have this case, mg is this way. This is, suppose that this is just a vacuum, of course. All these experiments are done in vacuum, otherwise we cannot do this. There is no electric field, but there is a magnetic field. Say the magnetic field is in this direction as before, in z direction, b0, okay? So this is our x and this is our y. Now, as you see, this cross that gives you the drift in this way. So the charge will move in the minus x direction, because mg cross b gives you in this direction. So now the guiding center drift is towards left, one of the electrodes which are not really applied any potential difference, basically. Okay, so this is done. This part of the plasma physics is almost completed, except that we will solve some now time-dependent problems, but the equation of motions are solved this way. And don't forget, the initial conditions are so important to determine the exact solutions, okay, which usually shows like circular motion with some kind of drift, or maybe helical motion. We have seen that the object also can do helical motion, usually in the direction of the magnetic field, okay? So this is the end of this recording, and okay, now you can ask me the questions if you have.